Coming up on today's show, you may have seen some of the dashboards and visualizations using Excel with Power BI. You might not be sure how to get it all working. Today, Lotus F1 Team walks us through the steps they took to visualize their operational data so they can speed up the time it takes to get new car parts to the track. We'll show you their shift from predefined reporting with SQL Server reporting services to data discovery and interactive exploration with Power BI, including preparing the data, building the relationships, and enabling Q&A so that anyone can query the data. Keep watching to see what they're doing with car telemetry and learn their longer-term aspirations for predictive analytics. Before I visited the team to catch up on their hands-on implementation, I caught up with COO Thomas Meyer to hear their goals. So this is an organization that generates a ton of data, right?
Absolutely correct. We collect 2.5 billion data points per car, per race. They all come from the telemetry system which all the teams use, which are around for many years now. But beyond this already existing system, we are trying to correlate actual data coming from the car, combining it with external sources to give us insight, which ultimately leads us to be able to predict data into the future.
Beyond even what we see at the track, bringing this back to the operational side of things, what are your goals around analytics on the operation side?
Now we have to make this data visible because it's a lot of data and people need to be able to abstract the data, so we make them visual to them to make faster decision and bring the parts faster to the car, which ultimately leads to performance of the car. And for me, obviously, it's important that I can write my own reports without being dependent on an IT department, so I can just do writing a query and I have the report I need.
Excellent. So that's the view from the top. Let's roll up our sleeves and catch up with the IT team to see how they're delivering on this. So Carolyn, I know you've been tasked with visualizing Lotus F1 Team's operations and manufacturing. Mm-hmm. How's that going?
Yeah, really well, actually. We've made some really good progress over the last 4 or 5 weeks. This is our dashboard that we've built. It's got some pretty powerful and interactive views of our operations.
And I know a lot of people, Carolyn, are really wondering how these are made, because you see a lot of the kind of finished product of Power mm-hmm. BI. But why don't you tell us how you got started with Power BI here?
Well, we've got a lot of data, both in our current and our legacy ERP systems. Mm-hmm. And our first step was to talk to the business and find out what the key requirements were.
And that's always a first step if you think about really gathering the business requirements. But mm-hmm. it changes a little bit with Power BI. So Carrie, you've actually got a SQL DBA background. How did that go?
Most of my knowledge is around writing SQL queries and using SQL Server reporting services. Now I'm in charge of business intelligence. We chose to look at Power BI. But I wasn't so familiar with data modeling in Excel or certainly the new Power BI tools.
And how do you set out learning this?
So my first inclination was to start using SSRS, write the SQL queries, and to give Thomas the view that he would want of the data. That would have been pretty easy, although the downside, he wouldn't then be able to explore the data any further and interrogate it in different ways. So it was a mindset shift for me. Here's an SSRS report that I've used before. As you can see, it's not as visual. I had to predefine the data that we brought into this report, and you can't really drill into it or interact with it in any way. If Ian had one of those sort of what-if questions mm-hmm. and wanted to explore things a little bit further, I'd then have to go back to the drawing board, write a new query, and build a new SSRS report, which would have all been quite time-consuming.
Mm-hmm. So less interactive in those what-if scenarios,
exactly,
really hard
yeah.
to kind of cater towards. How did that change with Power BI?
So the shift for me was in realizing that with Power BI, you're bringing in much more data and then you're exploring that data with the visualization tools. And then it's pretty easy to create visualizations and start to identify patterns in the data.
Great. Well, let's start walking through some of the steps. So Carolyn, mm-hmm. why don't you kick this off?
Okay, so first of all, we translated our reporting requirements and found a data set that included that, but more. We didn't want to just restrict it to the initial requirements that the business gave us.
Okay, and Carrie, how do you go about doing that?
So now with the Power BI desktop app, I brought in all the data directly from our SQL database. You could also do this in Excel using Power Query. The functionality is very much the same between Excel and the desktop application.
And Carolyn, how do you guys choose your data set?
Well, because we're not using predefined queries, we didn't limit our data set. We were optimizing for more data discovery and exploration. We want to overshoot the data that the stakeholders initially requested because that's going to help us later on as we develop the dashboard.
And how do you go about preparing and modeling your data?
So step two is really about building those data relationships and building your data model. Unlike SSRS, you spend a lot of time up front connecting the tables and building that model. Then you don't need to prepare data every time you want a new view. So first we connect to our SQL Server database and choose which tables or views we want to connect to. Okay, now we've brought our data in, we can see that we've got two tables and it's discovered that there's a relationship between those two tables on the table ID. You can also go in and manage those relationships, create new ones, or you know, edit the relationship if you need to.
Carolyn, how did you go about bringing in data from multiple sources? You had legacy and current ERP systems.
That's
how
right.
did you match that together?
We started with our current ERP system. We looked at the legacy data and see how we could transform and align that with our initial data set. We are now bringing in data from both systems, and that means that we can go back for 5 years.
And how do you go about doing that, Carrie?
We then used SQL queries to help us bring the old data and the new data together and to bring that into our data model. You could also do that using Power Query or DAX.
DAX is really designed to work with relational data, perform dynamic aggregation, also so that you can find patterns more easily. Mm-hmm. I know that DAX is really a big part in your adopting Power BI. Why don't you explain how easy it was to learn DAX?
We primarily used it to group relevant data together using DAX. So I'm going to create a new calculated column here. This will be for working out our estimated hours. I know this is made up of our calculated process field and our calculated setup field. So that's very quick to create. I can then change the data type of that field. We're going to make it into a decimal. And then I can create a new calculation based on that new field that I've just created, which will be a total of the estimated hours, which you'll just use the sum feature. So you can see it's got some similarities to the Excel formulas.
So once you bring in the data, you've built all the relationships, can you start to visualize that now?
Yeah, that's right. So step three is really about exploring the various relationships and starting to build up the dashboard. At this stage, it's all just drag and drop. We can just bring in our total estimated hours calculation that we've just created, mm-hmm. And we can then slice that by operation in this example, and it gives us a nice bar graph. We could also just bring in that total estimated hours and just view it as a number if that's how we'd want to see it. So Thomas or Ian could really interact with this and build new views on the data however they want to see it, really.
So now you're almost ready to actually move on to the next step of publishing it, right?
Yeah, so we need to publish this up to powerbi.com before we can move on. So I'll hit publish. So now you'll see in powerbi.com, we've got our new data set in there, which is the file that we've just created. And we've got reports in there as well. If we go and explore that, we can see the visualizations that we just created in the desktop application. I'll then create a new dashboard, which at the moment is just blank. If I go back into the reports that I just created, I can then pin those to that dashboard, and it'll tell me there that it's pinned them to the dashboard.
So we caught up with Thomas earlier, and he was really impressed with Q&A and how to really create custom views against the data. Did you have to do anything special to enable that?
Yeah, so the importance of that was back in step two. When we were building the data model, we had to make sure that all our columns are named correctly. Mm-hmm. That then builds a vocabulary that Q&A uses so that when you start to interrogate that data, it knows what you're talking about, really.
And now that you've got the dashboard published, how do you go about sharing that out and setting up permissions?
So it's pretty straightforward. Just from the dashboard in PowerBI.com, you can choose share, and you can literally just put in the email addresses of the people you want to share it with, and you can choose whether they have the ability to then share it on with other people.
So this is another connected service. You can see through the Active Directory who's there, or automatically populate those names. So you've got everything working. You've got all the five steps gone through in terms of what you've done to build out Power BI and really get it published out. And what were some of the people's reactions when you were starting to first show Power BI to people?
It's been really good, actually. Manufacturing particularly have been particularly pleased. I think this is going to be a real help for them to improve the efficiency of their operations. So it's been good.
Initial impressions is pretty amazing. Before we had many different programs we had to use. Now we get the overview on the dashboard, which is great. And then you drill in as much as you need. For example, it's an actual versus estimate on hours we consume to make a part. We choose that graph, we select open that graph, it goes into the full screen. I can then drill down on any of the resources on that graph to fine tune exactly what I'm looking for the information I need.
So in a month, the team was able to visualize their operations data. Thomas also discussed interest in other Power BI scenarios, such as car telemetry. I met with Mark Everest, who oversees Lotus F1 Team's advanced telemetry systems, to find out more. So Mark, we saw how the data models are created with Power BI, and we've got some seriously big data here with the Formula One cars. How have you been looking at Power BI?
So we've imported a lot of the telemetry data into Excel. And when I say a lot, I mean I'm talking about millions of rows. And what we can do with that is we can correlate different data sources and try and spot patterns, can create different views of the data that we might not have been able to before.
And you got some of that running here?
Yes, certainly. So this example here shows the GPS data from two cars for the same race plotted on a map. So we can see there a familiar track map that most people might recognize. We can also pull in individual channels of data over a period of time. So looking here, we can compare brake temperatures for different setups, so different cars. And we can see there that the brake bias might have been set differently on each car. And again, we can see that the behavior is different.
So this is Excel, but what about Power BI itself? Where do you see that coming in?
We can look at this as a way to expose data to users that might not be able to use our existing tool set.
Okay.
Most people are familiar with Excel, so picking up a tool like this is very simple for them to do.
And beyond what we're seeing here with Excel and Power BI, where do you see this going? What's the future of scaling these insights?
Well, we have an awful lot of data. So for example, a 90-minute race for a single car generates about 2.5 billion rows of data. So finding somewhere to host all of this information for us to be able to use is what we're looking for. So to me, the obvious option is to use the Azure Data Lake. As well, we can import different types of data, for example, track conditions or weather data. We're also looking at using machine learning and predictive analytics to spot patterns in the data that we might not have seen before.
So lots of progress since our last visit a few months ago, where Power BI was planned but not yet implemented. Now it's time to go back and get Thomas's reaction. So we're back with Thomas. Now, Thomas, we just heard from the IT team. What do you think about their progress?
Really pleased with the progress. They did an amazing job. Now I have a tool at my hand where I don't rely on their capabilities of writing reports. Now I have a Q&A tool where I can query the data myself and get a report instantly, like works order for Monaco by year as a tree map.
Right, and we also met with Mark, who's also looking at ways to use Power BI with car telemetry data.
Yes, that in fact opens a completely new way of approaching data analytics. It will let us visualize correlate data in a way we never done before, and it will be ultimately bring us performance to the car. And you need to think in a very different way at the moment, because now we have this theme saying, if you can think it, you can visualize it.
Great closing note. That's about all the time we have for today's show. Next time we visit Lotus F1 Team, we're going to look at their journey to modernize their travel logistics app from something paper-based and static to something integrated with Office 365 email and calendar. Of course, you can watch previous shows for Lotus F1 Team on Office Mechanics. Thank you for watching, and goodbye for now.